Hello, and welcome to Mulavi Learning's online CPT lecture series for librarians. I'm Dr. Angelo Juan Ramos, and today our lesson is on data visualization, how to make your data tell a compelling story to incite action. So, at the end of this learning video, you will be able to first enumerate the characteristics of quality data. Next is to discuss the reasons why libraries collect data, explain the proper flow of data to action, define data visualization and its importance in the work of libraries, discuss the effective uses of data visualization, including how to use infographics as well as introducing you to some online tools, and finally, we will learn how to make a library communications plan. So, this learning video is made for librarians who use data to promote your library collections and services, when you reach out to your community, especially when you would like to demonstrate the impact of your programs and services, and to convince your partners, supporters, and stakeholders of the value that your library brings to them. Okay, so let's start our lesson. So when we talk about collecting data, before everything else, we need to assume that the data that we collect is really of really high quality data. And I'd just like to quickly run through some characteristics of good quality data. First is accuracy. You need to collect data in a very accurate way and make sure that you don't have any misses. Next is to collect reliable data. Next is you have to make sure that your data is complete and it should be consistent in the manner of collecting it, in the manner of getting information from sources. It has to be consistent every single time. It also has to be timely. You need to collect data as much as possible at that specific point in time. Don't wait for weeks to pass by before you remember that you need to collect data. And finally, data has to be relevant. It has to be useful for you, for your institution. Otherwise, it's going to be a waste of time collecting all that data. As librarians, we need to ask ourselves why we need to collect data in the first place. So what questions do we need to ask ourselves in terms of collecting data? First, as a librarian, you have to think, what data do you collect regularly for your library? Do you collect data on the number of users? Do you also get data in terms of their ages, their gender, what services they are availing of, etc.? And you have to also ask yourself, why do you do it? Why do you collect data? Is it merely just to comply with the administration's requirements or office's requirements? Or is there some other deeper reason why you need to collect data? And how do you collect and gather your data? So you know that there are different ways and methods of collecting data. So do you do any of these things, like collect data from observing what is being done in your library, doing some interviews of clients and how they are satisfied about the services that you're providing? Do you provide questionnaires? And do you also keep a database of all this data you are collecting? And who is going to be the users or recipients of your data? Is it for public librarians? Is it your mayor? Is it your city administrator? For public libraries, is it the administrator of your school? Is it your boss, etc.? So who do you think uses your data? Now, what is very important is that whenever we collect data, we make sure that the data needs to be translatable eventually into an action. Because it's really pointless just to collect data from a daily basis and you just keep it and we don't know what to do with it and no action is being done in response to the information that comes from the data. So I'd like to just show you the flow that we need to observe from data to action. So we start with the data that we collect, you know, either on a daily basis, weekly, monthly, etc. Okay, so we gather the data. And it's very important that this data needs to be translated into information because data itself might not be useful or might be hard to interpret. So you need to transform that into some packets of information that you and other people can better understand. But beyond that, once you process the data and converted it into information, this needs to be translated into knowledge. So you've collected data and come up with information through it using graphical or other means. This has to be translated into something that is new or something that you can derive knowledge out of. And from that knowledge, okay, there needs to be some form of decision that needs to be made because from data to information to knowledge, you need to make a decision. For example, if the knowledge coming from the data is that in one given month, only 50% of your usual clients have visited your library. So what do you need to do about that bit of information and knowledge? And if you make a decision, of course, you need to act on that. Okay, you need to make an action based on the decisions, knowledge, information, and data that you have collected. So this is the flow of data to action. And in terms of visualizing data, it's very important for us and very helpful to visualize this data so that we can really easily manage this flow all the way up to deciding on what to do and acting on it. And the practice, the science, and even the art of data visualization is really thinking of ways that you can convey information through visual representations. And when you do data visualization, it allows you as a librarian, as a professional, to visually access huge amounts of data into visuals that are digestible or to packets that are easily digestible and understood by people. I guess some of you might be collecting a large amount of data in your specific institutions. So it's important to visualize this data. And at the end of the day, I was mentioning that data visualization is an art. It's an art because when you really start to visualize your data, this is where your skills at being a storyteller comes in. Because data visualization at the end of the day is really all about telling a story to users and really engaging users to understand and to appreciate the story that you are telling them. And it's very important for us eventually, you know, when you practice data visualization that you need to find that sweet spot because there's this intersection between collecting data, making that data more visual, and turning that visual into a story that people can understand and appreciate. And that sweet spot in the middle is really merging all of these three, telling a tale, making some graphs, and really applying art into this equation. So for example, this is one way that data that you can collect eventually gets transformed into information and to knowledge and becomes data that you can easily visualize. So for example, if you look at this table, which really shows some statistics and trends about the Philippines being a digital nation, okay, you'll notice that, you know, it talks about population and then the number of internet users, social media users, mobile connections and users. It can tell a good story, and looking at it, you know, you can derive some information and some knowledge out of this, you know, if you compare it just from, you know, looking at raw data. But the art here in data visualization is thinking about how can I make this data or this information more appealing. So perhaps, for example, maybe you can present data like this. Diba? I guess this would be more appealing, more visually appealing to those who will look at it, and comparing it to the previous slide, you know, looking at the trends here, and you see a lot of pictograms here, illustrations. This would be something that will capture the imagination of more people, and they can more easily understand the story that you want to see, that you want to say to these people through sharing your data. So as you can see, data visualization itself can be a very complex practice. Actually, there's a whole science behind data visualization. And if you really want to learn more about how to be a good data visualization expert and a data scientist, it really takes a lot of learning. But we are here to talk about the really introduction and really basics of data visualization. And maybe as a start, I'd like to share with you six ways or six tips that you can effectively use data visualizations. Okay, so the first thing I'd like to share with you, that data visualization is really used to analyze, right? So for example, you know, you have raw data like this. So for example, this is a table of the different public libraries in the country, where, for example, the National Library of the Philippines collects data on the number of users per library on the monthly basis. So if you look at this as is, it can be a bit difficult to analyze or get any story out of this. So we need data visualization to help us better analyze trends, right? So one good thing that you can do to really make this more visually appealing is to convert this into graphical format. And you know, there are different ways or different kinds of graphs that we can use. So one common type of graph is a line graph, which is commonly used if you want to really quickly show trends that are happening. So this is one good example if you want to see, in this case, a library in the US showing that there's this steady increase of the number of computer users in their library per capita from 1 year to the next. So that's a line graph. Another example would be a bar chart. So it also can help you look at trends and visualize data better. So this graph is an example of what we call a bell-shaped curve. You know, it's a population curve, wherein in this specific example, you will see that in the Philippines, you will see the proportion of people from different age groups, great age ranges, and it's also segregated between the male and female people in the country. So looking at this, for example, you can surmise that the Philippines is a fairly has a fairly young population, because you see that most of the population is in the age ranges of, let's see, 25 and below. And another common way that you can visualize data is to using pie charts. So, but if you look at the specific pie chart, you know, actually this is not a good way to make a pie chart, because if you see this, there's actually a lot of data points here. And looking at this pie chart showing the populations of the different cities and provinces in the Philippines, you know, if you can see how to make this pie chart better, for example, maybe you don't need to also show the proportion of the population of the smaller cities anymore. So because look at it, it's pointless to really show them, because it's they're very, very small. So maybe just maybe show maybe the first five first eight most top most populated cities, and then the rest you can just put others. So that's a better way, for example, to make this pie chart more appealing. So in general, if you make graphs from your data, it can help you you know, identify trends. It can also help you identify anomalies, because maybe that there will be some data that you have missed, or maybe you have made some mistakes in collecting data. And sometimes when you use a graph, you can really see that there's this anomaly. For example, there are strange spikes in your line graphs. You know, you can also look at correlations and even patterns. And you know, when you convert your data into graphs, that can be information that is more easily digestible. So now you can come up with knowledge, and you can make better decisions, and then eventually actions out of these graphs that you made. The second way that you can effectively use data visualization is to use data visualization to discover something that your data is saying. And you really, a good data visualization can help you mine data to discover more information, especially if you really do it in a really nice visual way. So here's an example. I would say that this is one of the first infographics in the world. Actually, this drawing is from the 1850s. Okay, this is a, as you can see, it's a map. It's a street map of a specific area in London, England, during the 1850s. And this map was drawn by a doctor there, a public health doctor called John Snow. He was investigating an outbreak of cholera in that part of the city. And the way he did it was he used gathered information of the number of patients who suffered from cholera. He got their addresses and actually used this map to plot, you know, the location of the different people who were struck by cholera. So for example, each of these dots corresponds to a patient, right? So he mapped all of these out, and he noticed that, you know, many people who suffered from cholera tended to, you know, congregate in this area, in this area called Broad Street. And but so looking at this map, he became very curious. What's, you know, he was saying to himself, so what's going on in this area of Broad Street? So once he got this map, drew his map, he actually went to the street itself and went around and saw and was trying to investigate what was it in the street that was making a lot of people sick. And he noticed that, and he marked this with the X here, he noticed that at the middle of Broad Street, there was this water pump, you know, yung poso. There's this water pump here where people were getting their water from. And but he also discovered that in this water pump, you know, if you can imagine during the 1850s, you know, there was not a lot of plumbing, proper planning and sanitation back then. So a lot of the waste of these people, they just threw it in the street, and many of this waste ended up going into the water supply. So you can imagine people drinking the contaminated water and getting sick from cholera. So this map actually that the Dr. Snow made is actually a very pivotal point in the history of what we call public health, because from here he was able to prove that the cause of cholera was poor sanitation and dirty water. So this is a very, very good way to discover things by visualizing data. So a third way to effectively use data visualization is to use it in support of a story, because the right data visualization can help you emphasize key points. You can provide context and can even better engage your audience. And you know, sometimes if you really, really do a good visualization, it can make it more memorable. So for example, this graph, this infographic here, this poster here, you know, presents data to convince, I mean, this poster was made for teenagers in some schools where they noticed that there was a high rate of teenage pregnancy. So this poster, they used it to convince or to try convince teenagers that to be careful about being pregnant at an early age because it's expensive to have a baby. So you notice all of these costs, costs of prenatal checkups, what is the cost of giving birth in a hospital, and then what is the cost of child care, and then they have this estimate like 150,000 pesos in the first year. So, and then if you notice here at the bottom, they ask the question, okay, so knowing all of this, can you afford to have a baby? So it supports the story, that supports the story here of the cost of having a baby right now in the Philippines. This is this one good way of doing data visualization. And number four, data visualization is also a way wherein you can tell a story by itself, without words, without sentences, even with just a really good picture. You can show data in a very, very compelling way. So look at this example, no? This is a infographic or a picture that Facebook made. It basically shows here all the active areas in the world where people are using Facebook. So the way they presented that data is that the most number of users who used Facebook are really shown in the white light. So you can, if you notice that they've superimposed the data on the map of the world, and looking at this, you can see that, okay, a lot of people really use Facebook in places like this one is the United States, this one is Europe, and then over here in Asia, you can see that there's a lot. India is really lighted. This is Indonesia, and of course, the Philippines is very, very well lighted and represented. And it also goes to show that a lot of Filipinos are really active in using Facebook. And you can also compare it. For example, there's a good story here. For example, this is the area where China is. But if you can see, it's dark, right? So why is it like that? Because if you know, actually Facebook is banned in mainland China, okay? For various political purposes. Actually, China has its own social media platform. But Facebook is banned, so basically, you do not see China, lighting up in this map. Another good graph here is this one, showing you areas in the Philippines where there's a lot of earthquakes. So just looking at this map of the Philippines and then all of these data points, that is superimposed, showing all of these earthquakes and magnitudes. You can see that, almost all of the Philippines is really earthquake prone, except for, look at this. This is Palawan. And apparently, looking at this, you can surmise that no earthquakes take place in Palawan. So, the next useful way to use data visualization is really to teach. Because in today's day and age of easy visuals, there's been a lot of studies that have shown that we learn more effectively and our brains really function more effectively if we are presented with information that is in a visual manner rather than written. So we learn more. So as librarians, if you want to teach concepts, it's better to present them in a more visual way. So here are just some examples. So this one on the left, it's one of those popular posters that you can buy, for example, in national bookstores that you can use to teach children a lot of different concepts. So for example, in this case, the different Philippine national symbols. And they're presented here in a nice way, and the different national symbols like the national bird, the national flower, sampaguita, and all of the national sports, etc., are presented visually and graphically. So, for example, this other poster here on the right is, you know, a really good way to teach people, for example, the seven steps, for example, on cleaning and updating your computer and mobile devices. So these are good examples of using infographics to teach. Okay, and the sixth tip that I can give you is that you can really use data visualization techniques to convince people, to convince you know, your bosses, to convince people in your community, for example, to go to your library more or to use your services more, right? So, for example, this is a infographic, a data visualization that we've done in one of our projects. So, my organization, Malawi Development Foundation, is implementing the Beyond Access Philippines project. So, for the past 4 years, we've been helping libraries doing a lot of trainings and capacity buildings like what we're doing now. And we've been teaching concepts of providing new innovative library services. So for example, we've been training many librarians on providing services related to digital literacy, e-government, and workforce development. And you know, we've developed this infographic because we wanted to convince other government agencies, other institutions, or even people who will give funds and support that they need to support libraries because libraries are doing a lot of good work. So in one infographic, in one data visualization exercise, we are able to show and convince all of these people that, you know, all of these people are really being trained or providing new services, and there's been a steady increase in the number of library users and computer users in many libraries around the country. So in our experience, when we made this infographic, it was really, really effective in convincing other people. So for example, you've had many government agencies now helping libraries by giving them more computers, by converting them into technology centers. So that was a good way for us to get more partners by visualizing the data that we've been gathering from libraries. So again, just to recap, these are the six ways that we can use data visualization for our libraries. So again, we use data visualization to analyze our data, look at trends and other correlations in our data. Number two, we use data visualization to discover things from the data we've been collecting. We use data visualization to support a story, to tell a story in itself, to teach, and finally to convince. So I've been talking about infographics so far, and you know, the reason I've been saying that, the reason where I've also been giving you several examples, is that actually infographics is now really a very, very fun, quick, and really creative way of visualizing your data. And it's really the trend right now. Many organizations are doing infographics. And, you know, basically, an infographic is an image that you create, and then you put in graphics, you put in text, and also statistics and numbers that you put there to explain or to show a certain subject. And it's very important, and this is where the art comes in, that you be very creative in making your infographics, because this is really a good way to let people understand much better what you are trying to say. For example, you want to make a poster that promotes the services of your library. So if we make it into a very, very engaging and creative infographic, people will appreciate it more and you will get more visitors coming into your library. So this is a good way for you to start learning how to make your own infographics. So basically, an infographic is really a data-rich visualization tool to tell a story or a thesis. And it's, you know, it's there's a lot of studies saying that 90% of information is transmitted via visually to the brains. So which means that you really we really process a lot of information through our eyes. And a good infographic is really 30 times more likely to be read than just plain text. And so if you imagine that, you really get a lot of retention from people and better understanding if you present your data in a really engaging visual way using an infographic. So for example, if you want to present the 2017 Philippine budget by the different departments, do you present it this way? Is this a good infographic? I don't think so. You know, it's a bit colorful, but it's not very engaging. So how about this? You know, there's a new trend right now of many organizations, many companies. What they do now is they use an infographic to make their annual reports. You know, so for example, this public library in Canada, in Burlington, Canada, the way they made their annual report is through an infographic. So it's just basically one poster or one page highlighting all of their different accomplishments in the past year and even their financials. So, you know, traditionally, right, you know, for those of you who have been making annual reports, traditionally you do a lot of writing and then come up with these thick books, you know, showing all the financials and all the things that have been, that you write down about what you've been doing in the past year. And, you know, I guess many people actually don't read annual reports, right? So it's actually a waste of time and a waste of energy and resources. So I guess now this is a much quicker and actually easier way to come up with your annual report by doing it as an infographic. So actually, if you are really good in illustrations, you know, you can actually make your own infographic, you know, but just by using colored pens. If you're really, really creative, like this example, you can really come up with a very, very engaging, colorful infographic, even without a computer. So, but you know, you have to be really, really talented in illustrations. But I have to really go back and to emphasize that the very, very basic thing in data visualization is that even before you embark on it, you have to make sure that the first step in gathering and collecting data, you have to really observe those different characteristics of quality data. Because especially when you enter information in a computer, the computer will really not be able to identify if that data is of good quality or not. So basically, it's going to be garbage in, garbage out. So if you put in, unreliable, inaccurate data, you know, it's going to be basically garbage in. And then when you make, you know, when you make your graphs, when you make your infographics, etc. But if, you know, at the beginning, the data itself is really not of good quality, you will end up with really garbage products, you know. So your analysis, making your infographics, doing data visualization will only be good as the data that you have collected. So I'm just trying to point out that it's very, very important to start out with really good quality data. Otherwise, you know, all of the work that you'll be doing in visualizing data will be pointless. Now, before you embark on creating your infographics, as a way to communicate to your stakeholders, I'd like to suggest that you draft what I would call an infographics communications plan. And I'd just like to share with you the different elements on how to do one, no? So let's start with the first part of the plan, which is to come up with your communications objective. So this is an important part, starting off point. You really need to define what your objective is. So for example, if you'd like to create an infographic because let's say you have a new collection coming into your library, maybe your communications objective can be, to promote to our library users our new collection of books. So you can write it that way. So that's your communications objective. And then number two, identify your target audiences and be very specific about it, because different audiences have different ways to be you need different approaches on how to target them with specific messages. So for example, don't just say, let's say your target audiences are students or children, so be more specific. So let's say from the first example, if your users, or for example your new books are children's books, you can say that your target audiences are elementary school children. Okay, and then number three, you have to also list down what you want them to do. So for example, from the two previous examples, we can say that if your objective is to promote the new collection of children's books, and then your target audiences are elementary school children, what do you want it to do? You can say that I want the children to go to my library and then read the books and maybe also borrow them. Okay. And number four, what are the data and the information that you need and sources to come up with data for that? So for example, the information needed would be, you know, the titles of the books, the number of copies, like that, and then maybe other sources. For example, if you're saying that if your communications objective, let's say as a public library, is that you'd like to encourage more people to come to my library, you know, your data information needed to get that would be data coming in from your logbooks, and other ways that you get the information from users. Okay, and do you need to come up with images or illustrations or charts? So you put it here. For example, do you need to get pictures that you will need to come up with an infographic? Where will you get the pictures? Do you need illustrations? You need someone to draw something when you make up your infographic posters, and maybe if you need charts, you need to develop some charts. Okay, and then number six is what tools will you use? So I'll be sharing with you two examples of infographic software in a bit, but you can also put here what kind of tools that you can use. So you can, you know, if you want to be a bit more traditional by drawing posters, you know, you can say that you are going to use, you know, crayons or colored pens. And then maybe some of you are more adept, for example, at using desktop publishing software like Photoshop. It's better that you list them here. And then number seven, what are the promotional channels that you will use? So where will you put the posters, you know? Do you put them in public areas like bus stations, like, you know, at the bulletin board at the entrance of your schools, you know, where people can really see whatever you're promoting, or they will see your posters. Okay, and then number eight, you can also put in here who will be the responsible personnel. For example, who is going to be responsible in making the illustrations or collecting the data or posting the posters, you know? So it's also good to have a list of who will be responsible to do what. Okay, and you might also want to put in the budget for this. For example, budget for you know, printing out the tarpaulins that you will use to promote your services, or budget maybe for new books. And then number 10, what does success look like? This is also very important, and sometimes a lot of people who do communications planning forget this. You know, how do you know if your your campaign is successful? How would you know if your communications objective is being met? So, for example, do you need to say that, okay, my campaign will be successful if X number of students come in here every day or in a given month, or X number of people will be using this new books, or X number of senior citizens will come to my public library. So this is one way you need to also determine how you will monitor and evaluate the success of your initiative, and then what metrics that you will use, and the next steps. So you can also list what are your plans. Do you want to scale this up? Do you want to come up with more campaigns? Do you want to produce more infographics? So this is also a very good thing for you to really see how you can sustain or really scale up the initiatives that you have done. Okay, so our organization, you know, Mulavi Learning, we have more comprehensive training programs on data visualization and infographics, and this can, you know, these are 1 to 3 day activities. But for the purposes of this introductory video, you can go out and check these two examples of web-based applications that you can use now, so you can start doing simple infographics. No, so these two applications, these are very popular right now. One is called Canva, and you can access it at www.canva.com. Another one is PictoChart at www.PictoChart.com. So both of these are web-based applications, which means that you have to be connected to the internet and use a web browser to access these two applications. So, you know, just go and choose either one of these and go there and then play with it and then practice with it. And if you're interested really to undergo a more thorough workshop on how to do infographics, just contact us here at Mulavi Learning. So basically that's it about data visualization. So if you have more questions, you can just email me at mulavilearning@gmail.com, and I'd like to invite you all to like and visit our Facebook page. That's Mulavi Learning on Facebook. And I'd like to thank you for taking the time to watch and learn from our online CPD videos. And please go back, you know, please go to our website so that you can access even more learning videos and you can earn CPD points for your profession. So again, thank you very much. Have a nice day and God bless.